The vast majority of video games are self-contained releases. You buy a game, you get all of its content. Even games with DLC, expansion packs, and microtransactions release more or less as complete games. Yet one format bucks the trend: episodic games. Existing in one form or another for decades, episodic games exploded in popularity in the new millennium. Developers and publishers took to the format as online distribution systems enabled new forms of video games to be created. And while episodic games were made across multiple genres, they became associated with adventure games thanks to the genre's resurgence. Today on Game Files, we're taking a look at episodic games. We're going to dive into the format's origins, find out how it became popular, and see what the future holds for a business model that is still searching for stability. Episodic gaming has its origins in the 70s, specifically with automated systems Temple of Apshai. Released in 1979, it saw a number of expansion packs and mini episodes released over the next year that expanded the original game. Early games like this weren't episodic in the way that we picture them today, but it is the first sign of the format's existence. That was how episodic games were for decades, though some did try to expand the boundaries of the format. Wing Commander: Secret Ops was released episodically over the internet in 1998, which was not a good business decision considering it was 1998. Others, like Famicom Mukashi Banashi Shin Onigashima, released physical copies of new episodes within a short period of time that formed a single game. Overarching narratives were few and far between this era, which blurred the line between what was an expansion pack and what was a new episode. One of the few games to feature a lengthy narrative, Shining Force 3, took 3 years for all three parts to be released. As the 2000s dawned, episodic games had yet to be anything more than a footnote in the video game industry. But thanks to one developer and new distribution models, that would soon change. Telltale Games released Bone, out from Boneville in 2005, creating the template for what episodic gaming would become. Episodes would be released within a few months from each other, feature a continuous narrative, and typically end in a climax teasing the next issue. Bone would be more memorable were it not for the fact that it ended after two episodes. Fortunately, Telltale's next game, Sam & Max Save the World, did release every episode to completion and was much better received. Telltale's modus operandi was simple. Take an IP, make it into a 5-episode adventure game, and repeat. Franchises like Back to the Future, Jurassic Park, and Monkey Island were examples of this. But it was with 2012's The Walking Dead that Telltale reached critical mass, rocketing it to the top of the industry and popularizing both episodic games and the adventure genre to boot. And since digital infrastructure was now capable of supporting full game releases, Telltale was off to the races, with new games like The Wolf Among Us and Tales from the Borderlands. Telltale had made episodic games mainstream, and with it came a host of developers looking to take the format and make it their own. Shortly before Telltale changed episodic gaming forever, developers around the world began to experiment with it. Valve's Half-Life 2 episodes are the most well-known, but it's likely that it will never be completed. American McGee's Grimm was a platformer that had a ridiculous 23 episodes, but never managed to achieve widespread popularity. Even Sonic the Hedgehog became episodic, with Sonic the Hedgehog 4, but it was scaled back after it didn't prove to be successful. Perhaps the most strangely successful take on episodic games can be found in 2016's Hitman. Focused on assassination, the monthly releases allowed players to explore each level repeatedly and discover all of its secrets, a format that was well received. And outside of Telltale, other developers coupled the format they had established with the revitalized adventure genre. Don't Nod's Life is Strange proved to be very popular, getting a sequel and prequel in short order. Kentucky Route Zero is a cult classic, marrying magical realism with economic horror. At the time, episodic games looked like they would be a key part of the video game industry's future. And then, that dream fell apart. In a sense, the decline of episodic games mirrors the rise of streaming TV, which caused people to gravitate towards shows that could be bingeable all at once. Waiting an unknown length of time for a new episode that you have to pay for upfront is a much harder ask. Hitman, despite being loved by many, was financially disappointing by all accounts. Life is Strange 2 took over 400 days to release in full, and its sales fall behind its predecessor. Outside of a few committed developers, Episodic Games fell by the wayside. Its biggest death blow came when, in September 2018, Telltale Games announced that it would be closing its doors after its last investor pulled out. As the biggest supporter of the format, Episodic Gaming's future is uncertain. The reasons for its success, its ease of distribution and lower budgets, came hand in hand with problems that few planned for. Episodic Games won't go away, yet they likely won't be as popular as they briefly were. Which is a shame because they can create experiences that you cannot find anywhere else. Maybe they'll return to the spotlight one day, but for now, we can only sit back and wait for the latest episode to arrive on our doorstep.